I am Assistant Pastor Ivy, and the title of tonight's message is The Power of Humility. The Power of Humility. I meant to remind you to get prepared before you stood up before the prayer so that you could easily transition and have those notebooks and pens already ready. But again, I'll go slow in the early goings as we get into this message. Title of the message is The Power of Humility. Now, I know that those are two words that you don't usually catch in the same sentence, but you can have power. You can have it as authority. You can have an ability, any type of power, but you can have humility. But I'll say to you that one usually precedes the other when it's balanced, and that's humility. It comes before the power. Amen. The purpose of this message is to help believers with the transitions in life by understanding the power and example of humility. To help believers with the transitions in life by understanding the power and example of humility. With this message, as always, I ask God, what message would you like for your people in this time, specifically for them? What he put on my heart was transition. So two words, transition and humility. And I believe that this word from God tonight is something that is an in-season word for you specifically and for our church. It's you don't go wrong when you ask God about the message first. Amen. So the theme that I'm teaching from is humility. That's what we've been teaching from on Tuesday evening. So humility is still that thing. The objective, first objective is you'll be able, you the believer, will be able to understand the power and example of humility. You'll be able to understand the power and example of humility. Because we do have some examples of humility who've operated in power throughout the Bible. We may not get to them tonight, but I should certainly mention, I believe that our Lord and Savior, Jesus, was a humble Lord and Savior. He operated in humility, but he certainly operated in power. Amen? There were other people in the Bible like David who operated in humility. He had to have patience and wait. But he operated in power. People like Joseph in the Bible, who certainly operated in humility. From the pit to prison to the power of the throne. But humility preceded it. And there are some things that we can do in order to operate in that humility. So that first objective, you'll be able to understand the power. An example of humility. The second objective is you'll be able to understand the power of humility in transition. You'll be able to understand the power of humility in transition. And we all go through some transitions in life, all type of transitions. We go through some transitions on our jobs, some transitions in our relationships, some transitions in our church, amen? Some transitions in our family, transitions throughout ministry. And so we go through some transitions, and it would behoove us to go through those with humility and faithfulness. And again, we'll talk a little bit more as we go through. For those who just came in, the title of this message is The Power of Humility. Two words you don't generally get in the same sentence, power and humility, but certainly they go together because we have examples of it. Tonight, we're only going to get to two main points likely. If I throw in a third, it's because I believe that the Holy Spirit told me to, but we're going to go to two main points, and those main points are there is a power in humility, and the power of humility in transition. At that point, it'll be my attempt to give you a summary and a review and send you on your way with spiritual food. Amen?
Amen.
All right, so let's take a look at our foundation scripture that we started with, which was 1 Peter 5:6. 1 Peter 5:6. The power of humility. And so if we keep our purpose in mind, help believers with the transitions in life by understanding the power and example of humility. A message that is for right now in your personal life and in our church, in your ministry, in your relationships, on your job. 1 Peter 5:6, reading from the King James, humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God, that he might exalt you in due time. As we go a little bit further, I want to, maybe I'll just wait a little bit on that definition, but I'll make a statement before I go into this scripture a little bit further. Statement is this: it's up to us whether we go through some things in life. Like I said, we have transitions on our job and our family and our ministry and our church and our relationships. But it's up to us generally if we go through or if we grow through while we go through. Amen? Because this is grow to go, right? And so as we go through some things, we can grow through those things. And that's something that humility certainly helps with. When looking at the big picture in life, it seems that many things regarding self become comparatively small. Comparatively small, if we operate in humility. And so I'm going to read a little bit further. If we looked at verse 1, chapter 5, verse 1 in 1 Peter, we'll see some of the humility, we'll see some of the order of God, who he's talking to. He's talking to the elders as he begins this chapter 5. The elders which are among you I exhort, who am also an elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that shall be revealed. Feed the flock of God which is among you, taking the oversight thereof, not by constraint, but willingly, not for filthy lucre or money, but of a ready mind, neither as being lords over God's heritage, but being ensamples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd shall appear, ye shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away. And so when he's speaking to the elders, we're not just speaking elders in age, but we're talking about the leaders of the church. And in a church like ours, pretty much everyone is a leader, seasoned people who have been serving continuously. But there is still a leadership in the church. You got your church board, you got your church officers. And God is saying, lead these people, but don't lord it over them. I mentioned before that one of our examples is Jesus, who operated as both a king and a servant, who operated in power, yet in humility. He was humble. But that is our example. That's one of the examples that we have as we go forth as leaders. And then he goes a little bit further in verse 5. He says, likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another and be clothed with humility. For God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. So I want to point out, one, as we look into the definition of humility, that it's something that's willing. If you look at what we just read, there's a willingness there. I mean, he could force you into subjection, but that's not what's going on here. Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves. So that's you submitting yourself. That's you doing something willing. That's you making a choice to do something, right? And anytime there's a choice, even when you don't feel like you have power, when you have a choice, you got some power. And that's generally something, no matter what type of victim I'm talking to in counseling sessions and such, if we can find out where your choice is, that there we can find your power. There we see that your will was involved. It wasn't something that you were forced to do. And so there has to be a willingness to put yourself in a lower position, or to put someone else, in this case, I'm gonna say God, in a higher position, someone who I'm going to reverence, or I'm going to submit myself to. Then he's saying, ye younger, submit yourselves, or willingly subject yourself, willingly place yourself under those who are your leaders. Follow them. Amen? Amen. Humble yourselves. Let's look at a definition. We're moving into main point number one, which is there is a power in humility. And we've already begun to talk about that power in the introduction. Again, just having the power to choose rather than being forced. You know, even when we talk about subjects like love, God never forced us to do anything, because it just wouldn't be love if he forced us to. Amen. It would be something totally different. So we always have this choice. He'll tell you the route to go. He'll tell you this is what's going to produce the results. Line your will up with my will, but generally you have a choice to do so. Amen? Amen. And so that's us submitting ourselves. So definition, humility, and I get this first one from vocabulary.com. Humility is the quality of being humble. Humility comes from the Latin word humilis, which literally means low, just low. Strong's 50:13. To make or bring low. In fact, I'll spell it for you. T-A-P-E-I-N-O-O. That's T-A-P-E-I-N-O-O. That's Strong's 50:13. But it says to make or bring low, humble, humiliate, to be humbled, to depress, to humiliate. Now, if I left you right there, I know most of the young people, you know, because they say we keep losing the millennials. Most of the young people don't really want to hear it at this point. So you want me to depress myself. You want me to just be low, but there's more to it. A lot of times when we look at these definitions in the Strong's, we have to go just a little bit deeper. What are you really saying to me, God? What is your heart? And so it's more than about just being low. In fact, I have this statement, I'm gonna say a quote from C.S. Lewis. I wish I had thought of myself. It goes right with this. It says, when looking at the big picture in life, it seems that many things regarding self become comparatively small. But then C.S. Lewis also says, true humility is not thinking less of yourself, it's thinking of yourself less. Amen. Amen. It's just thinking of yourself less. And you do that when you look at the big picture, when you're able to look at what is God doing, when you're able to look outside of yourself. When I'm thinking of me, it's going to be difficult to see the whole forest, because I'm just thinking about what's right there in front of me. If I'm conscious of self rather than God conscious of what it is he wants me to do or he needs me to do. And so if that is the case, it's going to be a little bit difficult to remain humble. In fact, I'll have a better chance remaining in my flesh if I'm just looking at me. Amen? Amen. And so, again, we want to take it up just a little bit further with the definition. As I dug a little bit deeper, looking at Strong's 50:13, It is to show humility, true lowliness happens by being fully dependent on the Lord. That's where you want to begin to key in at. Being dependent on the Lord, not just being a low life, so to speak. I'm low. I'm a wretch. Look at me. Save my dirty self. No, that is not what God wants you to do, to think low of yourself or have a low opinion, because that's not going to be consistent with who God says you are in Christ. So it's certainly not, humility is not to think low of yourself in that regard. But we shouldn't esteem ourselves in comparison to the world. Now, when we put ourselves in position with Christ as to where he is in our life, where God is in our life, then we'll properly esteem ourselves. We're not comparing ourselves to what the world did or the world standard or mark, but we compare ourselves to where God says we are. If he says I'm the head and not the tail, those are the things we're looking at. We measure ourselves by the word, not by the world, is what I'm saying. Amen. And so, a little bit further in this definition, it says, happens by being fully dependent on the Lord. Then it goes on to say, dismissing reliance upon self. Dismissing reliance upon self. We can do all things through who?
Christ.
Not through Alphonso. When it's reliance on self, all type of stuff can go wrong. But when I rely on God, when I put my trust and my faith in him, when he's the object of my faith, then I know it's already done. One of the first things I learned out there in those hospital visits doing the MAP program, it was understanding that I can take the pressure off of myself because I'm not the healer. I'm not doing it through me. It's I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Amen. And so when I would go into these hospitals, regardless of what would happen or what the outcome would be, because I don't know everything, I'm not God, I'm not the Alpha and Omega. I'm just a conduit in that moment to be used. I'm a vessel. And to lay my hands on the sick, the word says they shall recover. Whatever happens after that moment, I don't know everything. I don't know where that person's faith is. I can only know what my faith is. I'm going to be a willing vessel, humble before God, used, and I'm going to do what he said do. Amen. Now we can say obedience, or I can come back over here and say humble enough to be obedient, humble enough to subject myself or put myself under. Because as I was reading those scriptures, there was an order there too. He started speaking to a certain group. Because God does things decent in order. Amen? Amen. And so he started talking to the leadership. Then he went down to, again, not low lives here. These are just maybe lesser leaders. I'll put it that way. But there is a structure. And God is always a God of order. And so dismissing reliance upon self or self-government. And I like this. Emptying carnal ego. Emptying carnal ego. This exalts the Lord as our all in all and prompts the gifts of his fullness in us. Again, that it prompts the gifts, the gift of his fullness in us. I even jotted down a quick little definition of ego, a person's sense of self-esteem or self-importance. A person's sense of self-esteem or self-importance. But for us, the believer, that self-esteem should always be based on Christ. Amen?
Amen.
And again, I don't want you to leave thinking humility or is something low. I have to think of myself as less, because you're not. Because if I leave you with think of myself as less, now we got to come all the way back around later on to help you to operate in authority. But I got to pick you up off the ground and make you not feel homeless and orphan-like to do that, which is why it's not about thinking less of yourself. And so that is we have to point that out and just speaking out of the spirit. And maybe this is for somebody in here, but you know, low self-esteem will masquerade as humility. And so you have to ask yourself, when I'm willingly putting myself under, I'm willingly putting myself behind, is this a time when God said to do that? Is this a time when I'm putting myself behind because I value myself less? Or is this a time when, oh yeah, this is of God. This is what God told me to do. And I'm saying there is a distinction. And I know it because I've experienced it myself. I know it because there have been some times in my life where, oh, you go ahead and go, you go ahead and do it. But that wasn't the day that I was being kind. And I knew it wasn't because I was being kind, because in my mind I was mad. I didn't want him to go. You know? So what that was, put the lesser value on myself and just not operating with boldness. And that's not what God wants. Because again, if we don't get those two and balance them, it's going to be tough if we get into some kingdom thinking. It's going to be tough to tell you that you're a kingdom citizen. But all of this is about putting ourselves willingly into subjection and knowing from whence our authority cometh. Amen. So even if I don't say it or spell it out in a great, orderly, precise form in the scriptures, it's about submitting yourself to God and understanding that the authority, all authority flows forth from Him. And when we get into self-reliance, see, our flesh will block up that channel where power is flowing. Our flesh will be the thing that cuts something off. We want to let God flow. Well, that means take a step back. Let God do what He does. Or as the folks said in the old church, let go and let God. But that's about stepping back. That's about taking your hands off of it. It's about not self-reliance, but relying on God. It's about understanding there's I have authority to do things that God calls me to do. But there are some times when I don't understand what's going on. I'm going to pray in the Spirit. I know the Spirit leads me and guides me into all truth. But just because I can't figure it out at that moment, that doesn't mean begin to rely on myself, because it gets you in trouble. That's what happened to Abraham and how he got to Ishmael. Instead of stepping back, operating in faith, humility, patience, he chose to go ahead and be with Hagar. And that's how he ended up with Ishmael. So we're going to go a little bit further. I'm going to tell you something that humility requires. I was just talking about it there, but humility requires understanding of order. Just based on these verses right here. We can go several more, but understanding of order, understanding where is our source. If I don't understand that order, then I'm going to jump over that order. There's a reason why in the military they have chain of commands. And I know not everything is the military. But it was a great deal of just teaching respect and teaching order. Not to jump over the captain or not to jump over the person that's supposed to be over me, when I could have handled it at the lowest level. So humility has something to do with understanding of order. God spoke to the elders and the high leaders, then the other leaders. Humility, number two, is an understanding of choice. We saw in verses 3-5, it shows that we have a choice to willingly subject ourselves or not. Neither is being lords over God's heritage, but being in samples of the flock. Now, this is a choice with the elders and with those who are the younger. If there wasn't a choice, God wouldn't put it out there to say, neither being lords over God's heritage, but being in samples to the flock. Just the fact that He has to say that means somebody tried to do it. As my police friends tell me, or the lawyer friends tell me, most of these laws were created for somebody. Mm-hmm. Somebody tried to jump across something. Somebody tried to violate. And so we have a choice in the matter. So again, understanding of choice. And then number three, faith. Faith. Humility requires faith. Hebrews 11:1, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Faith is the reality of those things hoped for. The proof of the things that we do not see. What I'm saying there, well, what does that got to do with humility, Sister Pastor Ivan? It's going to be difficult to be humble if you have no belief in what God has established for you. Again, that's exactly what happened to Abraham. Now, you always have a choice to jump ship. It's been several times, especially when I'm talking to this group, this remnant, several times you had an opportunity to leave this church. But you didn't listen to your flesh. You listened to God. I mean, you could have went out there and found you the Church of Hagar. Like, I'm just going to handle this myself. I want the dual visions back. You know, it's tough when you've been somewhere, like the children of Israel, where you had steak and then you went to manna. You start looking back. It's easy to do that. It requires faith to remain humble. That's why I said, now faith is, first of all, it's present tense, the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. I'll give you a live example. I recall, and people have heard me tell this story before, but when Minister Ori, not now Pastor Ori, but Minister Ori, who was over the choir, she was as a pastor, she was as a mother, and it hurt some people when the split happened. Some people were hurt, some feelings were hurt. And I had to have serious discussion with my wife. I had to help her too, because she was hurting. This is like a mom. She was hurting. And so I had to pray. We had to get on one accord. But one of the things that I said to her was, I believe, and this was before ministerial apprentice, it was before MAP, this was before any ministerial training, it was just me setting up under the man of God, understanding I ought to hear from God, let us get back on one accord. If we have to leave, let's leave because God sent us. Now, if God sends you, that's fine. I'm going to teach you something over here, and I'm going to bring you back full circle. But that's not what was spoken. Let's not operate out of our flesh. Let's not operate out of the hurt. I hurt too, but let's get it figured out. And so what I spoke to her was, I believe that God has something for me to do in this church. I don't know. You know, I know little me who I don't say much to anybody. I don't stay here at the church. I try to get home and get to the game or feed myself. Yeah, same me who was up front, and I started easing back to the back and hoping people didn't see me so I could skip a few Sundays. Same me, but I believe that God has something for me to do in this church. And I wasn't quite sure, but I said, either I'm supposed to stay here like a captain of a ship until the last brick falls down. I'm supposed to see this thing home and be a shepherd for the people and make sure that the people have been done no harm. Or I'm supposed to take this thing to the new level, and I'm an integral part of that to be used by God to go to the next level in this church. And again, this is way before that time, before even being in a minister's program. This was just simply listening and hearing from God, hearing the voice of God and knowing I got to be humble and be patient. So I got a choice to make. I have faith, so I'm going to act on what I believe. Because I have faith, I can see with the eyes of my faith the things that I cannot see. I cannot understand them, but I'm not leaning to my understanding. I'm leaning to His, Proverbs 3:5. I can't see it. I don't know what's going to happen to our church. There's no way I could have saw a tribe of Judah, CCC, Amsel, split after split after split after split. No way I could have saw that. All I know is stand pat. And when you do that, now you can operate in that humility. But you got to do that in your relationships. You got to do it on your job. Don't leave because your flesh says leave. But I'm not saying it's wrong to leave. Just don't leave because your flesh said it. You leave if God sends you. That's different. Okay. And that is the very reason I've never judged anyone, because I just don't know what God has told them. And so, again, that is something that is necessary. I'll say those again. Understanding of order, understanding of choice, and having faith. Sometimes you're not going to be able to see the end of a matter, but you can still make a willing choice to humble yourself if you put your faith in God. How? By understanding these things. I'll say it again. Sometimes you're not going to be able to see the end of a matter, but you can still make a willing choice to humble yourself if you put your faith in God. How? By understanding these things. I'll give you the four and I'll give you some scriptures. You need to understand that He is the source of everything. He is the source of everything. In fact, I'll read the scriptures. You just jot them down. Because I'm going to move on beyond this. We got to understand that God is the source of everything. Colossians 1:16. For by Him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through Him and for Him. We know that He is the Alpha and the Omega. We know that He's the beginning and the end. We know that He's all in all. He's everything. Amen? Amen. And if we know that, if we have faith for that, if we see that in the Word, if we believe that, if we act on what we believe, then we understand that He is the source of all things. Amen. See, sometimes when you're not around for a while, you can forget about some things, you know, and it slips out of your mind. So that's why you got to constantly be in it, constantly be in it. Constantly get into the Word to understand and repeat the scriptures that you already know, but faith comes by hearing. But you meditate on these scriptures. You stay in them day and night like Joshua 1:8. Stay in them so that they will remain in your heart. We know He's the source of all things. Amen? Amen. See, what happens when you stray away or you get away from some things for a while, you can lose... I'm going to use the word atrophy. If I said that wrong, I'm from Tennessee, so it's an excuse. So just as there's physical atrophy, you know, I was benching, you know, believe it or not, but I was benching about 225 pounds when I was in the Navy because I was just eating a lot of meat and potatoes and didn't have nothing to do with float around on a ship out there. But I stopped working out about 7 months when I came back home. My brothers got me in the gym. I told them, yeah, put 205 on there. Let me just show you. I got it up there and went down. This wrist is still hurting to this day. That was back in 98 or so, 97. And so we do the same thing spiritually. You heard me teach a lesson called Faith the Maintenance Mindset. That faith is not static or standing one place, but faith is dynamic. Otherwise, we wouldn't hear terms like ye of little faith, ye of great faith, ye of no faith. That means your faith can go one way or the other depending on what you're doing. So you got to stay in the game, or the lesson like I taught the kids the other day was keep your head in the game. Because Satan got his head in the game. He's always coming. In fact, we know, verse 8, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. That's right after. That's 1 Peter 5:8. So again, Sometimes you're not going to be able to see the end of a matter, but you can still make a willing choice to humble yourself if you put your faith in God by understanding these things. He's the source of everything. God knows the end from the beginning. Said that before. That's found in Isaiah 46, 8 through 10. Promotion comes from the Lord. Amen. And cast your cares upon the Lord. So let me give you scriptures with those. God knows the end from the beginning. We said Isaiah 46, 8 through 10. Remember this and stand firm. Recall it to mind, you transgressors. Remember the former things of old, for I am God and there is no other. I am God and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times things not yet done, saying my counsel shall stand and I will accomplish my purpose. When you know that, when you know he's that kind of God, you'll put your trust and faith in him if you believe it. Promotion comes from the Lord. If we believe that God is the one that'll take us from one place to the next, transition I'm talking about, transition in your ministry, your relationships, church, no matter what, you'll stand firm. If you understand, promotion comes from the Lord. What scripture did I give you? Psalm 75, 6 through 8. For promotion cometh neither from the east, nor from the west, nor from the south, but God is the judge. He putteth down one and setteth up another. See, when you understand it, you'll stand so firm. See, I knew, or at least I felt it, when I was at St. Louis Christian Center way back in 99, I believe that this man is my spiritual father, I began to say to myself. It began to roll up in me. That wasn't the very first day. The first day was, this is not my Baptist church and the choir is not that good. I wasn't going to stay, you know, but I just kept coming back month after month and I stayed. And after I realized this is my spiritual father, another year or two passed, I said, well, man, he's not inviting me to the barbecue. You know, I don't know if I should do something, you know, make myself seen. But then I got a lesson around that period of time that said, you don't have to be up in the man of God's face. Promotion comes from the Lord. Amen. So then I had to take a step back. Like, man, that plan is spoiled. I can't, like, make myself show up at the barbecue. I can't make myself seen or do something special. So I sat back and I just did what I could do. I went to every class I was supposed to go to, marriage class, spiritual growth class, heavenly prayer language class, every class that's offered at this place, I did it. Sit back, mouth closed. But sure enough, God speaking through our pastor, I know to this day that it's true. I know that, and I'm not being, trying not to be boastful as I say this, but it's because we're teaching the message on humility, but coming out of MAP to be considered, no, not considered, to be the first person out of MAP to ever be elevated to just teach at the pulpit that pastor says, I don't bring you no junk. Amen. Oh, wait, there's a person. So. So. Yeah. Amen, amen. But to know, I recall asking Elder Johnson, I asked Pastor too, I was just trying to get the answers that I needed because again, I'm saying, but why me? And honest to God, I really did go through a list and say, but why not Mickey? Why not Marcus? Why not Herman? Why not Alvin Baird? You know, at that time, Elder Alexander had not been, I think he was in MAP like 10 years. I was like, for sure, he'll be. Program stopped, started, stopped, started. He was there every trip. And I could not get an answer, a natural answer as to why. And I just knew for sure, even my wife knew, Elder Johnson put in some good words for you, a lot of good words. I know that had to be it. But as I asked Pastor, his only words was, I know how to hear from God. He ain't seen me. In fact, the whole first year, I got elevated. I got the call March 19, 2016. For the whole first year, he kept calling me Alonzo. And so, so now every time I come to the pulpit for that whole first year after that, I kept saying, it's Minister Alphonso, Alphonso, not Alonzo. But it wasn't man. Promotion came from the Lord, amen? And so I don't have a lot of time to go into the next portion, so apparently this will turn into a part two. But as we think about the transitions, I just want you to keep this in mind, that humility can put you in position to transition to the place God wants to take you to. And so if that humility is not there, if that faith and faithfulness is not there, if that willing choice to remain in what God said, not what the flesh said, you may miss the transition to where you ought to be going. Or either that transition turns into a detour. But instead, you want to transition into the position that you ought to be, operating in the authority that you ought to be operating in, operating in the power that you ought to be operating in. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So, again, I don't know if I'm going to get into main point number two, so what I'll do is I'll begin to tell you a little bit about where I'm going next week. When I think about Joshua, and I won't have to spend as much time with it, but when we think about Joshua, we think about, so who were the two people, I'll just say it one, but the two people who actually were obedient when the spies were supposed to be sent into the land? Joshua and Caleb. So what I'm saying is, because you can look at it in hindsight, now they just had to operate in faith, but you know the end of the story, so you know that a transition was taking place, and it has something to do with faithfulness, humility, and obedience. There was a power of choice, a willingness that took place. Everybody else went in there, Numbers 13. We were as grasshoppers in their eyes. They were giants, and in our own sights too, in their sights. In fact, I laugh about how they felt little in their eyes, as grasshoppers in their eyes, but they also determined that that's how they looked in the other people's eyes too. That's everything but faith, nothing but fear, and it's not God's spirit. Because he didn't give us the spirit of fear. Amen?
Amen.
But oftentimes, it's creeping in there. The Bible doesn't always say a spirit of fear, but oftentimes the fear is coming when impatience is showing up. Fear was there too. I was afraid that God wasn't going to be as big as I thought he might be and bless me with this nation that he said he would bless me with. And so I'm going to skip out ahead and just hang with Hagar. But you got to stand firm. Sometimes it'll take 25 years to the blessing.
Amen.
But I'm not going to tell Pastor Melton's story. Sometimes it comes full circle. You just got to stay firm. I know what God told me. Who is looking bad? I know what God told me. I done lost all my hair now. I know what God told me. I'm about 72 years old and about to retire. I know what he told me. And you stand firm. That's your only job, isn't it? Stand firm. Do what he said do.
Amen.
And that humility puts you in position for the proper transition to your destination, that place that God calls you to be. There's a reason why many are called, but few are chosen. And so we'll go on into how it requires preparation, how it requires a mindset of remembering who God is always. The minute you forget, that's when stuff gets dicey. We ought to be able to understand that even in the natural, shouldn't we?
Amen.
Because when your kids forget who the parents are, some people have risen up, haven't they? You don't know who you're talking to. So we ought to understand, you know, that we shouldn't forget who God is. Amen. But we're on the good side of things, and we are his people. We are the blessed and blessed forevermore. We operate in his grace. We operate in his authority and his boldness. We're kingdom citizens, and definitely will not take you into a spot of being low, but only leave you with, again, don't think less of yourself, but think of yourself less. Amen?
Amen.
And the praise team is here, so I'm not going to begin to sing, "Just forget about yourself." And concentrate on him. Amen? All right. I'm out of time this evening. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.